Good afternoon, students, and welcome back. Before we get into our this particular session, like last time, we are again going to do a very quick recap as to what we did in the last session, because if you do not do that, we are going to lose the continuity. I hope by this time you would have all seen and followed the sessions that has been taken so far. Right from the beginning, that is 16th of this month. So very quickly, in the last session we discussed two very important strategies that a particular company or enterprise would follow, which would ultimately decide the structure of its supply chain. And what are the strategies? We discussed about the push and the pull strategy. We also discussed about the vertical and the horizontal integration. If you remember, we discussed, as far as the push strategy is concerned, how a manufacturer pushes, it creates a stock or inventory of a particular product and pushes the product towards the customer. It creates an inventory. The retailer creates a large number of inventory and then starts creating a demand, start pushing the product towards the customer, try to build a demand for the product through different promotional activities. It could be through hoardings, on-spot promotion, sales executives trying to explain the benefits of the product. So there are different ways and means by which we have often seen. We go to stores or supermarkets and we see new products, large numbers of new products being displayed and lot of information being displayed about that particular product, its benefits, its features, its price, its discounts, etc. And there are people, there are representatives from that particular company who is trying to promote the product by explaining the benefits. Whereas on the pull strategy, the manufacturer or the company do not build an inventory in advance. They do not do. They try to first create a demand. They try to pull the customer towards the product. How do that? They promote the product through advertisement, through media. By doing so, the customers feel the need to get that particular product. They would go to the distributor, the retailer, demand the product. And that is how the need or the demand is ultimately sent to the manufacturer, and they, based on the real time demand, manufacturer produce the product and deliver to the customers. Before I go further, let me tell you, this weekend few handouts, few study materials will be sent and that will be placed online. And the team will tell you how to access those study materials, because we have already completed 4 or 5 lectures sessions, and it is necessary for you people to go through the study materials and correlate with the lectures. Otherwise, we are going to lose the continuity. Coming back to the session today, we also discussed, student, about the vertical and the horizontal integration. If you remember, in supply chain, we talk of integrating different entities, different companies, different organizations, different facilities together. So integrating all of them is the key to the success of the supply chain of a particular company. Here we are not only talking of internal integration within the company. There are different functional groups in the company: marketing, HR, engineering, manufacturing, production, etc., research and development. While it is important that these functional groups work in tandem, work with each other, it is also important that a particular company also works with other companies who are a part of the supply chain. We discussed primarily two types of integration. One was vertical and the other one was horizontal. In a vertical integration, a company takes control of another company who's probably supplying the raw materials to him. By doing so, he wants to take control on another company who is a part of or who is contributing to the final product. We gave an example of an ice cream company taking control on a dairy farm. By doing so, he gets control on a raw material which is milk. By taking control on the dairy farm, the ice cream company ensures that he would get the quality of milk he requires, he will get it at the time he requires. He will ensure by doing so the supplier is not producing or delivering or supplying milk to some other company because he has the exclusive right on that particular raw material. In an horizontal integration, on the other hand, coming back to vertical integration, we also discussed about the two phases of vertical integration. One is up the supply chain and one is down the supply chain. In up the supply chain, vertical integration takes control of the suppliers. Down the supply chain, a particular company can also take the control of the distribution, that is its retailer, its distributors, that is the marketing process basically. So these are the again two subdivisions of vertical integration. Speaking about horizontal integration is basically merger of two enterprises or two companies. Listen very carefully. Horizontal integration is primarily merger of two companies who are primarily in the business of the same product or services. They are producing the same product or services. Very recently, I gave an example, very recently we have heard of two major telecom companies merging with each other in order, and what is the primary objective of the merger? So, our horizontal integration aims at increasing the market share. So, that was the primary objective of the horizontal integration. We have discussed enough in the last session. I am not going to extend this. We have given few examples, few live examples, some examples of a company like Walt Disney taking over other channels, doing a horizontal integration. This was just a recap. So, these are the two very important strategies that we discussed. After discussing, we actually went to the chapter of logistics system and logistics decisions. For a while, we go back to the slide which tells us the three main objectives, and it is very important to understand these three main activities of a logistics system. Please focus on the slide. The main activities of logistics system is order processing, inventory management and freight transportation. We discussed this last time. After an order is placed by the customer, the order is processed internally within the company. The product is produced, the item demanded is produced. An inventory is created for the customer. Inventory management is very important in logistics system. We will have separate, absolutely specific and separate sessions on inventory management. We will see how a proper inventory management can save a company, can make the supply chain cost effective. Inventory management is also about ensuring that we meet the customer demand, we meet the customer satisfaction while ensuring we are not exceeding our budget and costs. Once inventory is managed, we have to ensure that the shipment is delivered to the customer at the time that the customer needs. So, freight transportation, freight management is an extremely important area of the logistics system, is one of the main activities. So, it is one of the three major activities of the logistics system. So, what is a logistics system? We also discussed what a logistics system is all about. Logistics system is nothing but a set of facilities who are performing different functions, who are performing different activities. A particular facility may be involved with manufacturing the goods. One particular facility is functioning as a warehouse, storing or stocking the goods that's produced by the manufacturing unit. Then there is another facility who is involved in sorting the shipments. There's another facility who's involved with selling and consumption. So these are the functions or activities in a logistics system, and these facilities are interconnected. All the facilities that we have mentioned, this entire all the functions, manufacturing, storage, sorting, selling, consumption, they are all connected with each other by some transportation system. So, what are the functions? Manufacturing, we said manufacturing, we said transportation, we said stocking, we said warehousing. The functions could be assembly. A facility may operate only as a warehouse. It may operate as a distribution center. It may operate function only as a transshipment point. We all know what transshipment is all about. When a shipment does not move directly from one place to the other, but it breaks at a particular point and gets into another vehicle, or it gets into, or there is another transportation mode that is done from in that facility, it is called transshipment. So, a shipment coming from Delhi going to say Cochin can get transported in Mumbai or Bhopal or somewhere in between or Hyderabad. So, that is what is called transshipment. The facility can function as a transportation hub where shipments are loaded and unloaded from transportation and dispatched from that particular. It is only meant for transportation. That means transporters come to that particular facility and goods are loaded into the vehicles and sent to different either to the customers or the distributor, retailers as is required. It can operate as a terminal, as an end point where a shipment would come and deliver the goods, and that's all about it. It can operate as a sorting area, and very important in the current scenario, a facility can also work as a waste management area. We are looking at green, we are looking at a non-polluted atmosphere. The country has taken some very serious steps against companies who do not operate by maintaining a non-polluted environment. So, there is a lot of waste management. You know, in a factory, in an organization, particularly places which produces industrial goods, there are a lot of waste in terms of oils, gases. So, there is a need for the facility to maintain a waste management process. Now, what are the managerial issues? We are all here, you are all pursuing MBA or some, or you are in some business school, and you all aspire to be managers. And the primary function of this particular or objective of this particular course is to ensure that we produce logistics and supply chain professionals. So, what are the issues as logistics manager that we need to focus on? Some very important issues, because if you remember, we go back to one of the slides, the role of a logistics and supply chain manager is so important because logistics cost is one of the highest component among all the costs that a company incurs in a particular financial year. The country as a whole spends about 8 to 10%, which we have discussed when we started this particular session. So there is a lot of cost involved, there is a lot of money involved in logistics management, in transportation, in warehousing, in manufacturing, in storing, in transshipment, in waste management, in reverse logistics. Lot of money is involved. While we need to control, we need to be cost effective, we also need to look at proper customer service. Cost saving is of no use unless until customer satisfaction is ensured. So let's go to the slide and see what are the logistics management issues are, which are the areas that we need to focus. Capital reduction, cost reduction, service level improvement, cost versus level of service decisions, sale versus service, and optimal services. So there is a lot of capital expenditure, there are a lot of capital expenditure involved in a logistics system in terms of investment in plants, machineries, tools, manpower, etc. We have to ensure that we do not exceed the capital requirement or the capital that is allotted to run the logistics system in a particular company. We need to be very conscious about our day-to-day spending. So we need to keep the cost at the minimum level. As we had discussed, it is very important for a logistics manager to understand that he has to play a very balancing role between stock, between cost and customer satisfaction. Cost, customer satisfaction and service level, they go hand in hand. And it is the duty of the logistics manager to ensure that they create a balance. And we had discussed in the last session through a graph the relationship between service level, cost and revenue generated. And I don't want to extend on that. It is very important, I repeat once again, this balancing act to maintain customer satisfaction while ensuring that the logistics system runs at an optimum expenditure or cost level is very important, an important function of a logistics manager. We said logistics function is all about planning, implementing, controlling. Three very important words. So, logistics management we need to plan, we need to execute, after execution we need to control. What we need to plan, execute and control? The forward and reverse flow of goods and services. When we say forward flow of goods and services, we mean when a shipment is sent from the manufacturer to the customer, and the reverse flow is when a return good is sent from the customer back to the manufacturer. For different issues, the reasons could be many. It may be a damaged shipment, it may be a shipment that is which is not as per the contract. So this is the forward and this is the backward flow of shipment. So this is all about logistics management. When we say logistics management, we also discussed two very, very important areas of logistics, that was inbound and outbound logistics. We all know a plant or a factory or any unit in the supply chain, he would receive a shipment. So, if it is a manufacturer, he would receive raw materials. The raw materials will be processed and final goods produced. So, this is inbound logistics. Whereas, when the finished goods are sent to the customers, for a manufacturer, it can be sent to the distributor or the retailer. It is outbound logistic, finished goods. So, this is broadly. So, every unit in the logistics system, it undergoes an inbound and outbound logistics management. We are talking of a manufacturer over here. Now, think of the dealer. When the shipment receives the dealer, it is an inbound logistics or inbound shipment for him. The dealer in turn has to send the shipment to the retailer. So, he has an outbound logistics to manage. So, every individual unit, facility, functional group, they undergo an inbound and outbound logistics management. And we are going to discuss inbound and outbound logistics important, logistics management in detail in our subsequent sessions. I may be repeating, this is something which we have discussed in the last session, but it is extremely important for us to understand the basics of logistics system, managerial issues, what are the key issues that a logistics manager need to always consider for proper functioning of the logistics and the supply chain system. So, very quickly, we also mentioned about some emerging trends. Emerging in recent times, what are the factors which are influencing the supply chain of different organizations? One is the company's tendency to go global. Transactions with global companies are increasing by the day. A company may be based out of India, but he is selling to a global company, or he is procuring materials from a company outside the country. He is also merging, he is also collaborating with a particular company for a particular product or service. So, going global is increasing by the day. All leading companies, they have a tendency, because doing business with other countries is becoming very, very, very simple than what it used to be earlier. E-commerce, we all know what e-commerce is all about. E-commerce has enabled the consumers a very convenient way of transactions online. Today, almost every product is available in the digital market. We have different platforms. The companies themselves, they have their websites for transactions, for purchasing a product, for paying for the product, transacting for the product, and they are informing the customers every time online about the shipment, right from the time that it moves out of its facility to the time it is delivered to the customer. And e-commerce is only going to grow in the next few years or the next decade or so. Information technology was supposed to be a support system earlier. It's no more a support system only. It's taking a very vital role in taking business decisions. A lot of importance are given to information technology, analytics, data security. Almost every function in an enterprise is getting automated. This information technology only eases the process of doing business. Information technology has made information being transmitted not only within the organizations, but within different groups which are involved in the supply chain. Information technology is playing a huge part in ensuring better and better customer satisfaction. So, what are the logistic decisions, on what area the logistic decisions are taken? We will just refer to the next slide. Is the facilities. decisions on what size of a facility or what location, materials and components should we store or we should buy, manufacturing assembly finished goods, where to store, warehouses, should we buy warehouses or we should lease out, decisions on whether where should the spare parts be stocked, how should we plan the production process, should our warehouse have a system of racking or we should follow a system of stacking depending upon the kind of goods that we store, what should be the process of retrieval a good from a warehouse. Once a warehouse is short of items or products, how to resupply and refill that particular stocking point. What would be our mode of transportation? Is it air? Is it by sea? It is by train, because we have multimodal, we have multiple modes of transportation. Should we buy a vehicle or should we lease out a vehicle? What should be the scheduling of our shipment? Should it be on a daily basis or a quarterly or a weekly basis? What route should a vehicle follow? All these are logistics decisions. Now, what are the areas of decisions? Those the previous slides told us about the decisions. Now, what areas does it cover? There are different wide, for a logistics manager, he has to be involved in decision making in a wide range of areas. And he has to ensure that he takes correct decisions in those areas. He has to understand that whatever decision is taken, there is a relationship between all the decisions. There is a linkage between the facility, the functional groups, the functional areas. So, one decision can influence a decision, one decision can benefit another decision, or one unit can benefit another unit. On the reverse side, a bad decision can affect the entire supply chain. So, he has to understand this decisions is distributed across several department services. The entire supply chain itself is complex. He has to take decisions on a short term basis. There are activities where decisions are taken on a short term basis, like for instance dispatch of shipments, a vehicle routing, and there are strategical decisions which are to be taken on a long term basis, maybe regarding budget, in regarding manpower system. So, these are long term decisions. So, these are the areas of decisions that a logistics manager, logistics supply chain manager is expected to take. And there are three stages, students, we have discussed. The entire logistics decisions follow three phases or three stages: the strategic, the tactical and operational. Among the strategic decisions, he has to ensure that when he takes a strategic decision, it should last long. He does not need to change the decisions fast. He takes a decision on how the system would be designed, the infrastructure should be designed, what should be the location of a particular facility, what should be the capacity of the manufacturing unit, what is the quantum of production, what is the layout of the plant or the warehouse, what will be the size of the fleet, if they are owning the fleet, should they own it, if they lease out fleet. When I say fleet, I mean vehicles. So, what would be the size of those? What are the tactical decisions? Tactical decisions involve, we give an example, we have to understand the basic difference, and we discussed this in one of the sessions previously. There is a difference between strategic, tactical and operations. Once a strategic decision is taken at a very senior level, at the level of the directors and the CEOs, which are on a long term basis, it is the domain experts who needs to decide what would be the tactical activities to ensure those strategic decisions are implemented or made successful. We gave an example of a company wants to become a market leader, which is a strategy. A strategy is taken by the promoters of the company or the owners of the company that they would like to be the market leaders in their own area, whatever products they may be producing. So, that is a strategic decision. The tactical decision would be taken maybe by the marketing department, that they would do it, they would achieve this strategy by a reduction of 10% of the price, they would offer a discount of 10% on the price vis-a-vis what the competitors are producing. So, that is a tactical decision. Whereas, The operational decisions that we are going to discuss later will primarily talk of execution. So, tactical decisions take into account whether the decisions are taken on a monthly or a quarterly. So, while strategic decisions are on a long term basis, maybe on a horizon of a year or a couple of years or 5 years or 10 years, tactical decisions are generally taken on a monthly or quarterly basis, because there is a possibility of the decisions or the plans to change. So, it takes into account the production and distribution planning. What should be produced? How much should be produced? What would be the cost of production? What would be the distribution planning? We will discuss in future lectures that there are different distribution methods for a particular product, and the company, one particular company, has to decide which is the right distribution method that is going to ensure customer satisfaction, ensure that goods and services are delivered to the customers when they were required. Tactical decisions also take into account how the resources, a company operates through different resources, its manpower resources and other resources, how they would be allocated, how they will be used, how the existing resources would be used with a goal to achieve the strategy that has been decided by the promoters of the company. So, that is basically the tactical decision. So, in the operational decisions, operational decision is even at a smaller horizon. We said strategical decision is for a long term, tactical decisions are mid term, whereas operational decisions are taken either on a daily basis or on a real time basis. It can change based on a sudden change in the business, in the economy. It has a very narrow scope. It means that whenever a decision is taken, there is very, very small option of deviating from that particular plan or strategy. So, what does, for example, what are the operational decision include? It may include warehouse order picking. It may include how the shipment and vehicle are dispatched, how the order picking process would happen within a warehouse, what is the schedule, what is the time period, how they are to be picked, whether it will be manual, it will be automated, how the shipment be dispatched, at what time, what is the schedule of shipment being dispatched. So, right at the ground level, at the operational level, all the decisions are required to be taken, and decisions are based on some detailed data. Because as I said, there is very little option of corrections. This has a very narrow horizon, and a wrong decision may create disturbance in the logistic system and ultimately in the entire supply chain. If a picking is not done, dispatch will be affected. If a dispatch is not done properly, if a shipment is not sent, if a transportation is not managed properly, the goods may get damaged, the shipment may not reach somewhere, there may be pilferages, there may be so many other mishaps which can disturb the entire logistics process. Now, what are the categories? There are three categories of decisions: strategic level planning, network level, and at an operational level. So, what are the strategic, at the strategic level, what are the decisions that needs to be taken into account? Performance objectives. What are the objectives? How should the performance of particular individual should be measured? Integration decisions. We have discussed about the integration. What should be the integration policy of a company? Whether it is going to do a vertical integration, whether it is going to do a backward vertical integration, forward vertical integration, or it will follow both. Whether it is going to do a merger, thus following a horizontal decision, whether it is going to execute jobs in house or it is going to outsource to other companies. He has to define what customer service is all about. to what extent he wants the customer to be satisfied. So there has to, he has to define the objective of customer service. At the strategic level, he also has to decide on the metrics or the benchmark or parameters, the mission of the company, the competitive environment, who are the competitors, what are their activities, and what are its financial resources. We are going to come back in the next session after the break, and we are going to go to the other categories of tactical and operation decisions. Thank you for the timing.